From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to the JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. Thanks for joining us. I'm your host, Dr. Karen Lasser, Professor of Medicine at Boston University and Senior Editor at JAMA. Today, I am joined by Dr. Jean Ashburn, who is an Associate Professor of Surgery at Wake Forest University School of Medicine, and will be speaking about hemorrhoidal disease. Welcome, Dr. Ashburn, to this JAMA podcast.
Thank you so much for having me, Dr. Lasser. I'm delighted to be here.
As am I. It's a pleasure to have you. So to begin with, what is the difference between the terms hemorrhoids and hemorrhoidal disease?
This is such an important point to start off with. Hemorrhoids are normal tissue. We all have hemorrhoids, or any individual with an anal canal will have hemorrhoid tissue. This is normal tissue. It serves a purpose. It is lining of the anal canal that's made up of vascular and connective tissue. It provides protection of the anal canal during a bowel movement. It fills with blood to provide some benefit to continence. And so these tissues actually help us and provide a service. But in general conversation and anecdotally, we commonly will use the term hemorrhoids to refer to all abnormalities of the anal canal or hemorrhoid tissue. And that disease process is better termed hemorrhoidal disease. So hemorrhoidal disease is actually when these tissues become abnormal, when they become engorged with blood or create symptoms that are bothersome for our patients.
And so what is the difference between internal and external hemorrhoidal disease?
Hemorrhoids are described by their location in the anal canal. And our landmark that's so important is the dentate line, which is a few centimeters internally in the anal canal. Hemorrhoid tissue that's above the dentate line are known as internal hemorrhoids, and tissue that's below the dentate line is called external hemorrhoids. And this determination is very important with regard to how the tissue presents when it's diseased, and also really affects our treatment options as well.
Which we'll get to later in the podcast. But my next question is, how common is hemorrhoidal disease, and what are the main risk factors?
It's really fascinating to talk about how common hemorrhoidal disease is, as it is a very common occurrence. Hemorrhoidal disease affects about 10 million individuals in the United States. It's responsible for a lot of healthcare visits. In fact, about 4 million annual ambulatory visits. It's the fourth leading outpatient gastrointestinal diagnosis. So it is very common. And it comes at a cost to our healthcare system. The annual healthcare costs are about $1.3 billion per year. And what's so interesting is that we feel that this is probably underrepresented because so many individuals may suffer from hemorrhoidal symptoms or have hemorrhoidal diseases, but they never seek care for a variety of reasons, or they treat themselves with over-the-counter medications that are available, or they just deal with their symptoms without treatment.
And what are some of the main risk factors for hemorrhoidal disease?
Risk factors for hemorrhoidal disease are really unclear, I would say. Risk factors are not very well studied. The evidence is quite limited. But what we do know that there are some risk factors that are associated with hemorrhoidal disease that are important to know and talk about. About 40% of individuals who are pregnant develop hemorrhoidal disease. They most commonly have this in the third trimester. And interestingly, after delivery, this percentage goes way down. It's about 3% at 1 month after delivery, which is an interesting phenomenon. Additionally, we have evidence to support constipation as a risk factor for hemorrhoidal disease. Patients with hemorrhoidal disease are more likely to have characteristics that are associated with constipation, like hard stools or straining with bowel movements. Patients with cirrhosis also are a very interesting patient population to talk about because they can suffer from rectal varices, which is a separate pathophysiology, but can coexist with hemorrhoid disease or can be mistaken for hemorrhoid disease. And this is an important idea to remember when dealing with this patient population. And then Finally, we know that although it's not well studied, diarrhea is more common in patients with hemorrhoidal disease. And we know from some data that patients with hemorrhoid disease are more likely to have diseases that manifest as diarrhea. So this is an important risk factor to consider as well.
Mm-hmm.
And how do internal and external hemorrhoidal disease typically present?
Well, this is really important to note when evaluating a patient with hemorrhoidal disease as they present very differently. And it goes back to our conversation about the anatomy and how we classify internal and external hemorrhoid tissue. Internal hemorrhoid tissue that is above the dentate line is relatively insensate. And the classic presentation is painless bleeding. These tissues also can prolapse or protrude from the anal canal. So painless bleeding and prolapse are very common presentations of internal hemorrhoid disease. And if we contrast that with external hemorrhoid disease, external hemorrhoid tissue is below the dentate line and is innervated by the sacral nerves. And so this tissue is sensate. So these patients may report swelling, painless swelling, that is, or when these tissues get significantly diseased, they can produce acute pain. So they present very differently. And these characteristics of the presentation help us to differentiate the pathophysiology.
Yes. And you started to talk about this a little bit before, but can you talk more about the differential diagnosis for hemorrhoidal disease?
It's so interesting and fascinating to think about this, but what we find in practice is that patients commonly report that any abnormality of their anal canal is referred to as a hemorrhoid, or when a patient has an abnormality of the anal canal or bottom area, they will refer to it as a hemorrhoid, when in fact, there may be something else going on. And there are three or four very common pathologies that are very commonly mistaken for hemorrhoid disease. One is an anal fissure or a paper cut of the lining of the anal canal. This can cause bright red bleeding and pain similar to hemorrhoid disease. An anal mass or cancer can cause pressure, pain, or swelling and sometimes bleeding similar to hemorrhoid disease. And two other common pathologies mistaken are anal abscesses and fistulas. Both can cause swelling, pain, drainage. So sometimes it's very difficult to differentiate from symptoms only the etiology of the pathology. So there is a broad differential, and this is why it's so important to get it right when we see patients with anal complaints.
And I thought one really important point that you made in your review was that patients who present with rectal bleeding not associated with bowel movements should undergo colonoscopy to evaluate for colorectal cancer, correct?
Yes, I think this is a very important point. We see very commonly patients who are presumed to have hemorrhoids for years, when in fact it may be a more proximal pathology. And had this patient be referred for a colonoscopy, this pathology may be identified early. And that early recognition is so critical.
Absolutely. So how is hemorrhoidal disease diagnosed?
The critical components for diagnosing hemorrhoidal disease is obtaining information in the history about the characteristics of symptoms, asking the patient specifically about whether they're having bleeding or pain. When the bleeding occurs with a bowel movement is more hemorrhoidal related, but bleeding between bowel movements may signify a more proximal pathology like a cancer, and can help differentiate whether the patient might have internal disease versus external disease. It can also help to consider other differential diagnoses. For example, an anal fissure may cause a burning or sharp pain during or after bowel motions, and that may lead to a better diagnosis.
And which patients should undergo diagnostic anoscopy?
Anoscopy is a very important tool in evaluating hemorrhoidal disease. It can be used in conjunction with a very thorough external anal exam, which in and of itself can reveal a lot of important anal pathology, for example, an anal cancer or an anal abscess. Anoscopy can be performed if an obvious pathology is not noticed on external exam, or if there is a concern of the provider that there may be internal pathology, for example, an internal hemorrhoid disease.
And again, I think your review made the really important point that if anoscopy is normal, a colonoscopy would be recommended.
That's such an important point.
Yeah, let's turn to discuss treatment a bit. So what dietary and lifestyle modifications are recommended for patients with hemorrhoidal disease?
Treatment of hemorrhoid really is dictated by two important things. First, our treatment depends on the symptoms that the patient has and what the patient wants, if the patient desires treatment. So a patient with hemorrhoidal disease may not require treatment, or if that individual does not desire that. Dietary and lifestyle modifications are very important to start with. They're low risk. They're easy to initiate. Important dietary modifications include increasing water and fiber intake. The American College of Gastroenterology recommends 20 to 30 grams of fiber daily and 5 to 6 glasses of water. And this has been shown to improve symptoms of internal hemorrhoid disease, for example, prolapse and bleeding. Other lifestyle factors that are very helpful are modifying bowel habits. For example, achieving a regular bowel movement, for example, a bowel movement daily, and avoiding straining with bowel motions has been shown to improve hemorrhoidal symptoms as well. These are fairly easy to do. They're low cost, they're low risk, and they're important to talk with all patients about when they present with hemorrhoid disease.
And one question I have is, how many servings of fresh fruit or vegetables a day would be roughly equivalent to that 20 to 30 grams of fiber?
A lot of it depends on what the foods are, but it's roughly 4 to 5 servings a day will offer that individual fiber for the day.
And which topical therapies would you say are most effective medical therapies for hemorrhoidal disease?
Well, the most widely used topical therapy is hydrocortisone, but interestingly, it's not well studied. About half of the patients who have filed an insurance claim for a prescription medication or prescribed hydrocortisone, but it's not well studied. In fact, one of the best studies that we have are in pregnant individuals given hydrocortisone in the third trimester, and that's been shown to improve symptoms of pain and itching. So it's interesting that that's a very common prescription offered without a lot of data to back it up. Another more recent class of medications is called flebotonics, and they're medications that are prescribed for venous insufficiency. They've been shown to decrease itching and bleeding and also feelings of wetness, but they don't offer a significant reduction in pain. So that's one limitation, but they are not associated with a lot of adverse effects and therefore are commonly used to reduce symptoms or to delay surgery for patients who are not quite ready to proceed or undergo an office-based procedure or a surgical procedure.
Sure. And which patients with hemorrhoids should be referred for surgery?
Patients that have symptoms that are bothersome for the patient and that are not responding to other available therapies, either medical therapies, topical therapies, or office-based therapies, should be referred for surgery. In addition, I think patients who have symptoms that are concerning for pathologies other than hemorrhoid disease could be referred for their evaluation.
And can you talk a little bit about the difference between the office-based procedures and the surgical procedures and what the advantages and disadvantages are of each of them?
We have 3 general office-based procedures. These are, in general, procedures that we can do while the patient is awake in the office. They're quite easy to perform in many people, and they offer the patient minimal morbidity. They are best for what I would consider mild to moderate hemorrhoidal disease, so grade 1, grade 2, and some grade 3s, and those grades relate to how prominent the internal hemorrhoid tissue are or how often it prolapses from the anal canal. I want to bring up an important point that these office-based procedures are only for internal hemorrhoid disease. And this is because those tissues are insensate for the most part, and so we can manipulate them without causing a lot of discomfort for the patient. Prior to initiating office-based therapies, I think it's important to try these lifestyle and dietary modifications that we spoke of. They may help a lot of patients to avoid a procedure, and they're just good, healthy, lifelong habits in general, particularly if we do a procedure and we want to maintain the good outcomes of that procedure. But those office-based therapies are, in general, easy to do, have minimal morbidity, but they're less durable than surgery. So it's a trade-off that they may work well. They are associated with a higher recurrence than surgical excision in a traditional sense.
Sure. And the office-based procedures you're referring to are the banding, the sclerotherapy, and the infrared coagulation, correct?
That's correct. They can all be done in an awake patient, and they all have a little bit of a different approach. The most commonly recommended office-based procedure is rubber band ligation of internal hemorrhoid tissue. And essentially, it's the process of placing an elastic band around the base of that internal hemorrhoid tissue during the process of anoscopy. And what that results in is it's that tissue sloughs in the short term, removing the tissue. And then in the long term, it leaves a scar in that area to reduce the likelihood of that area recurring. But it's well tolerated. It's a short procedure. And interestingly, many patients are asymptomatic after about 8 weeks. About 85% of them will be. But the drawback is that these patients can recur. It can be performed more than once, so it can be repeated, but it's a relatively safe, well-tolerated procedure. The other two office-based procedures are less performed: infrared coagulopathy or injection sclerotherapy. Injection sclerotherapy involves injecting a sclerosant into the hemorrhoid tissue. It also creates some fibrosin in that area to reduce bleeding or prolapse, and infrared coagulation applies a wavelength of light to cause necrosis of that tissue, both reducing the hemorrhoid tissue. Those are also well tolerated, but are thought to have a higher recurrence rate and therefore not as commonly recommended by some of the professional societies that put forth guidelines on this matter.
Sure, that's really helpful. Is there anything else generalists should know about hemorrhoidal disease that we haven't talked about?
The thing that comes to mind is how common hemorrhoid disease is and how commonly patients assume that any anorectal problem is hemorrhoid disease. I think this cannot be emphasized enough. So many patients minimize their symptoms. They are uncomfortable or embarrassed to bring this up. And I think it's important for the generalist to know that all hemorrhoidal complaints should be evaluated by a lot of the measures that we've talked about today. With a low threshold of referring for a surgical evaluation if bothersome to the patient.
Sure. This has been really helpful. I'm Dr. Karen Lasser. I've been speaking today with Dr. Ashburn from Wake Forest University School of Medicine about hemorrhoidal disease. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Musisi at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.